Listening Library presents A Heavy Dose of Allison Tandy by Jeff Bishop. Read for you by Robbie Daymond. For my parents, Charlotte, Finley, and Steve. I thought that I was dreaming when you said you loved me. Frank Ocean, Ivy. 1. If I were to ask you, where is the worst place to run into an ex? You might say the supermarket, or on a date with somebody else, or maybe even at a family reunion. To which I would reply, 1, wrong, 2, wrong, and 3, for the love of God, man, stop hooking up with your cousin. There is a right answer, by the way. I can tell you with absolute certainty, the worst place to run into an ex is inside your own home. While you are splayed across the bathroom floor, neck deep in porcelain, your stomach hollowed out like the inside of a snare drum. Should I elaborate? Say you're me. Hi, I'm Cam. You're a senior in high school, just 2 weeks from graduating. Best time of your life, or so you've been told. Results may vary. Say you're head over heels in love with a girl. Let's call her, Allie. You and this Allie had been dating for over a year. Everything with you guys was good. No, better than good. Phenomenal. Stupendous. Second to none. Say that very same girl blindsided you, ending things abruptly and without explanation. Shredding your heart in the process. Real hatchet job. I've been thinking about this for a while. It's not you, it's me. I still want us to be friends. She played all the hits. That was in January. Now it's late May. The two of you haven't spoken since, not even a text. Say a couple of months after the split, you found out she was seeing someone else, but not just any someone else. The very someone else who you'd always known had a thing for her, who she swore to you was just a friend. Here's where it gets fun. Say that ex, you know, the one with the hatchet, was driving home from school one afternoon in late March when suddenly, inexplicably, she lost track of the road. Wrapped the hood of her car around an oak tree at the bottom of the Shermer Ravines. The skid marks are still there, branded on the pavement. So is the puncture her sedan left in the guardrail. Say she's been in a coma ever since, confined to a hospital bed just a few miles up the road. Unable to walk, talk, or breathe without the assistance of a ventilator. Unable to, hypothetically, materialize out of thin air inside your bathroom at 3 a.m. So I'll ask again, where is the worst place to run into an ex? The answer? Anywhere. 2. The sun isn't up yet and my mom is trying to kill me. The dash clock reads just before 6, so we're the only ones on the road, thank God. The good folks of Shermer, Illinois must be sleeping in, staving off their Monday mornings for as long as their snooze buttons allow. I'm not so fortunate. Attempting to doze with Dr. Cindy Garrity behind the wheel is an exercise in futility. Mom isn't a fan of posted speed limits, or stop signs, or the rules of the road generally. As we speak, she's driving with her knees, one hand on the stereo, the other fussing with the elastic holding back her sandy blonde hair. Shit, my turn. Suddenly, we're Tokyo drifting through an intersection, my forehead bouncing off the passenger window. Note to self, ask Dr. Vernon to check for a concussion. Jesus, Mom!
Language, Cameron.
Why do you have to drive like someone on bath salts?
How would you know how someone on bath salts drives?
Things are extra tense this morning since this little trip overlaps with her breakfast spin class. She looks the part at least, dressed head to toe in black athleisure, save for her clean white trainers. The official uniform of North Shore moms. They hand them out at PTA meetings.
I spoke with your father last night,
she says, pausing to sip from her travel mug. He's looking forward to seeing you walk the stage at graduation.
He's making a special effort to fly in, so I expect you to spend time with him. Okay, Cameron? Will you make sure to spend time with him?
Mom has this aggravating-as-all-hell habit of telling me something, then immediately following up with a question about the thing she's just said. She does this apparently because I don't listen. Her words. Mom prefers people listen to her. Probably why she became a pediatrician. People are extra attentive when it comes to their kids' health.
Cameron?
Yes, I'll spend time with him.
Don't take that tone with me.
What tone? That tone.
No tones were taken.
I turn my attention to a battle I can win.
Do you really need to have your window open and the AC on? It's like 60 degrees out. How can you say that?
Mom switches her mug from one hand to the other.
You know my hands get sweaty when I drive. What if I lost my grip and we ended up...
She cuts herself short, but we both know where she was headed. The 800,000-pound elephant hanging over all of Shermer.
Want to finish that thought?
Mom wrestles a tickle from her throat. Suddenly it occurs to me.
Wait. Are we going to the hospital or to Dr. Vernon's?
My pre-op visits took place at his satellite office. I just assumed that's where he'd perform my surgery.
Rich?
My mom calls Dr. Vernon Rich.
Only operates out of the hospital. It's standard procedure. Where did you think we were going?
The truth is, I hadn't. Thought, that is. I try avoiding it as a general rule. Not about where the surgery would be, how long it would take, what my life will look like once it's over. No, I'm allowed exactly one thought played on a loop. I am over Allison Tandy. My mantra for the last 5 months. They say if you repeat something enough times, you start to believe it. The jury's still out. Just don't ask me to say it out loud.
Why should it matter?
Mom asks. It's not like you haven't been to visit her in the hospital yet, right? I turn and face my window.
Cameron, you have gone to visit her, haven't you?
It's on my to-do list. Look, I know we just met, but if there's one thing you should know about me, it's that I have never written a to-do list. Things sort of just happen with me. I'm like a substitute teacher, just trying to run out the clock until the end of the day, compared to my mom, who writes to-do lists in her sleep. Seriously, if I croak before her, you can bet your sweet ass she's sending me up to St. Peter's Gate with a list of shit she wants done by the time she arrives.
You're kidding.
I can sense Mom's eyes on the back of my neck. Knowing Mom, I'm sure she'll process this new information with the patience and love any parent would grant a child struggling to cope.
That is totally unacceptable, Cameron!
Just kidding.
I didn't realize I had to go, okay? I must have missed that day of ex-boyfriend school when they went over what to do if your ex winds up in a coma.
How do we even know I'm wanted there? It's not like anyone invited me.
It's a hospital room, not a 4th of July party. You don't wait for an invitation.
I realize the two of you had a falling out, but that's no excuse.
A falling out? Is that what we're calling it? You need to stop letting your pride and self-pity get in the way. If the roles were reversed, I'm sure Allie would have been at your bedside on day one.
I'm not so sure about that.
All right, sorry. The minute she wakes up, I'm there.
Mom's still fuming, but she knows better than to touch that one. It's been 62 days since Allie's bumper met the wrong end of a tree trunk. 62 days without an update beyond the standard, she's stable and we don't have a timetable. At first, Allie's accident was all anyone could talk about. But once her forecast became less than fatal, people felt justified shifting their attention to more important matters, like their summer plans or the latest couple inflicting their continued bloodline on the rest of the world. Allie's being in a coma became just another fact of life.
like traffic on the Kennedy or the impending climate apocalypse. People still donated to the Save Allie Fund, established to help her mom with the rising medical bills, but that was it. For the record, I never thought for a second this would be the end for Allison Tandy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.